A very good evening and welcome to all of our distinguished panelists and all of those who will be watching our program today to the 9th round of the Herat Security Dialogue. Today's panel is on Afghanistan-Pakistan relations and the Afghan peace process. Today with us, an extraordinary panel that I have the great privilege of introducing to you all. Today's speakers include His Excellency Minister Muhammad Omar Dawoodzai, who is a special envoy of Afghanistan for Pakistan. Minister Dawoodzai previously served as the Chief of Staff of President Karzai, as Ambassador to Iran and Pakistan, as the Minister of Interior Affairs and Special Envoy on Regional Affairs for Consensus on Peace. We also have with us today General Assad Durrani, who in 1990 headed the Inter-Services Intelligence and post in 1993. After leaving the army, General Durrani became Pakistan's ambassador to Germany and then in Saudi Arabia. We also have with us today His Excellency Minister Mustafa Mastur, who is the senior advisor and special representative of the chairman of Afghanistan's High Council for National Reconciliation. Minister Mastur served as the general director of budget and subsequently as deputy minister of finance at the Ministry of Finance, as well as senior advisor to the chief executive of the National Unity Government, and was also the minister of economy from 2017 to 2020. Also with us today is Dr. Aisha Siddiqa, who is the author of several books on Pakistan's military, namely Pakistan's Arms Procurement and Military Buildup, and Inside Pakistan's Military Economy. Currently, Dr. Siddiqa is working on her latest book on sociology of radicalism in Pakistan and writes and publishes for several journals and academic papers. And last, but of course, certainly not least, we have with us Honorable Ms. Fawzia Kofi, who is a member of the negotiation team of the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. Ms. Kofi served as the deputy and representative of the people of Badakhshan of Afghanistan, the Walisa Jirga. And at the present moment, I once again welcome you all, and we can go straight into our questions. My very first question is for Minister Dawoodzai. Minister, in your view and opinion, what are some of the new challenges preventing the building of trust between Afghanistan and Pakistan? And how can both states address this trust deficit and establish what former Afghan President Hamid Karzai had called a civilized relationship? Minister Dawoodzai, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Good evening, Mariam Jan, Durrani Sahab, Siddiqa Sahab, Mastur Sahab, and Madam Kofi, if she is around. Good evening to everybody. So nice to be in this panel. Normally when we start talking about a subject like this, we visit history and then give our description and then give our recommendation. These days I am trying to do it reverse. I try with a recommendation first, and my recommendation to the panel and to anywhere I speak is that let's forget about the past. Let's not live in the past. Let's today and tomorrow. In the past, we didn't have the COVID-19, which we have now. And there are many other challenges that we didn't have in the past. We have it now, and we may have it in the future. Now, having said that, the main problem between Afghanistan and Pakistan, that is the main cause of trust deficiency, it's here. Pakistan fear that a stable Afghanistan may allow India to harm Pakistan's integrity. Likewise, Afghanistan helped Islamist camp extremists, and even in some cases terrorists, to destabilize Afghanistan, and it starts all the way back from 1973 when the first group of six Islamist leaders crossed over to Pakistan, and they were trained and equipped and used against President Daoud, and the episode goes on until now. So at present, Afghanistan's complaint or mistrust is that Pakistan may be still helping Taliban. At least one thing is clear, that most of Taliban's leaders are based in Pakistan. And even there are fears, this is not official, unofficial fear is that maybe Pakistan is even trying to build a replacement for Taliban. If Taliban somehow reconcile, then there may be a replacement group for that that is already being out. So these are fears. They are fears of each other. Now there are opportunities on both sides, and the problems have provided opportunity to us, and the global and regional geopolitical circumstances, the alliances that's built, that's broken, these all provided us with the challenges and with opportunities. One of the main opportunities, the rising China and its vast economic package that's offering to the countries around, particularly Pakistan and Afghanistan. The other challenge that's more immediate is that COVID-19 has affected the economy of both the countries, and in Pakistan, particularly the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa is more badly affected because of the closure of the borders, the crossings with Afghanistan. So we are starting a new chapter in our relationship. There are opportunities, like for instance, if I flag one of them, that for the first time I see that in Pakistan, the army and the civil government is on the same page. We don't have to talk to them separately and get separate messages. We get same message, same language. They are on the same page. This is also another opportunity. On our side also, there is a newly developed consensus, like for instance, the two main contesting election team, one headed by Dr. Ghani, the other headed by Dr. Abdullah. They are now part of the same team, and they're working together in full consensus. One is leading the peace process. So it's another opportunity that we are building on it. And because of those opportunities, unprecedented things happened in the past. We were witness to that, like a visit of Dr. Abdullah with invitation from Prime Minister Imran Khan, and the way the protocol he was offered. This was unprecedented in the recent history of the country, at least in the past 20 years. Very soon there would be more senior visits. We had a visit of our head of parliament with a big delegation. This was, I think, the largest delegation has ever visited Islamabad. And there was this conference for improvement of trade and transit, which again, exceptionally, it was hosted by Asad Qaisar, the Speaker of Pakistani Parliament. Pakistan unilaterally introduced a very liberal visa policy for Afghans. In the very near future, a senior Pakistani delegation headed by Razak Dawood, the right hand of Prime Minister Imran Khan, will be visiting Kabul. And that would be followed by visit of Prime Minister Imran Khan and then President Ghani. Now, the change from our side, the change of thinking and the change of approach from our side is that in the past 19 years, we were specifically asking Pakistan to help us with the peace process. Like, for instance, we would demand that they should force Taliban leaders to come to negotiating table and talk to us. That never worked. Now we have changed the whole concept. We have identified six areas of cooperation. Out of that six areas of cooperation, one is in respect to Pakistan's cooperation with the peace process. And we are not claiming in that way, like force Taliban to come to negotiating table. Our language now is that we are grateful that you helped the US Taliban talks and you facilitated the Taliban's presence in Doha. And we expect you, as one of the six objectives that we have both decided and agreed upon, to also facilitate Afghan-to-Afghan talks. Well, Maryamjan, I can go on. I don't know how much time do I have. Maybe I take other people's time. I should stop here in case there are areas of interest that I should expand.
Yes, thank you very much, Doctor. I had two questions that I want to put out there for all the panelists, and you can feel free to answer whichever you'd like or both. I would just request to keep your remarks quite short. First is that we talked about, Minister Mastur touched upon the US elections, and I wanted to ask, with the Biden White House, with the Democrats returning into the White House, how do you see that shaping the peace talks, one, and two, how do you think this would impact Afghan and Pakistan relations vis-a-vis the peace process in the next year, let's say? And a last question is, Pakistan has fenced most of the Durand Line, which is restricting the movement of people on both sides who share tribal and, of course, family ties also. And this is having a negative impact on trade and the economy, which has been touched upon a lot in today's panel. Meanwhile, Pakistani Prime Minister recently spoke about this and about his desire of having a European Union type of free movement between the two countries. The question is, how can you reconcile these two seemingly contradictory measures or statements? So those are the questions, and I'd like to hand over the floor to Minister Dawoodzai to provide his remarks. And once again, you may feel free to answer all of them or any which that you prefer. Minister Dawoodzai?
Well, thank you again, and I would like to thank Dr. Siddiqa for speaking so eloquently. I agree with probably 99.9% of what the reality and the complexity is very, very well. Now, I wouldn't comment on the, how would it shape under Biden, because it's too soon. We don't know how his team will be formed, what is in his mind. Although we can do a bit of prediction based on his previous role as vice president. I was chief of staff to president at the time. And I remember that he and the Obama team was very keen to develop a comprehensive bilateral relationship between Afghanistan and Pakistan. And I hope he follows that line. Now here, with the new phase of our relationship, we are following that line of building comprehensive relationship as two neighbors that do not fear each other, that trust each other and that cooperate in all areas of concern, not limiting their relationship in terms of how to deal with the militants and how to deal with extremism. Of course, that's part of it. And like I said in the beginning, that's one of the six areas that we have defined. there are other areas, this whole domain of the bilateral relationship, we are working on a roadmap for that. The management of the Durand line is another issue between us that we are working on it. And again, we are developing a roadmap for it. A refugee return. We have millions of Afghans that are settled as refugees there. We would like them to see them to return back to their country, and so will Pakistan. Pakistan also would like them to return back to Afghanistan with dignity and honor. And then a very immediate area of focus for us is the whole area of economic cooperation. We are two countries that are highly depend on each other. Afghanistan depends on Pakistan. Pakistan depends on Afghanistan itself, and also Pakistan is seeking access to Central Asia, and Pakistan is seeing regional connectivity in its interest in regional connectivity roadmap. So to summarize, what I'm trying to say is that in the past, we were focusing on cooperation in the area of security and dealing with militancy and extremism. Now we are taking step beyond that. We are trying to develop a comprehensive bilateral relationship between the two countries who can live in trust, not fear.
Thank you very much, Minister.